Hi students, welcome to the course on cyber security. Myself, Dr. A.Murli Rao, Head of IT Department, Indira Gandhi National Open University, New Delhi. So, this session I would like to talk on defensive programming to secure IT systems. As we all know that the rapid changes of digital systems, at the same time there is a lot of vulnerabilities too by different hackers and attacks. So that's why now the defensive programming concept is coming into that, and which definitely ensures the business continuity of IT systems. See, just I'd like to just say that, you know, the topic precisely on again, what are various what is some digital infrastructure again deployed at network, then system, then application, and also at data layer. Then after that, what type of again attacks, and where the role of defensive programming comes into the picture, and then followed by various defensive programming techniques, and finally some concluding remarks. This is the overall the frame of this talk. See, just see that what is an IT system in a web-based network environment. See, the title itself gives a thought that is a IT system in a web-based networked environment. There is, so the IT system is deployed in, is a web based in a way, and deployed in a network environment. So if by keeping this in mind, so we can define that what is an IT system in a web based networked environment. Is a system successfully installed, configured, and commissioned by using different digital infrastructure, again at network domain where some routers, switches, cables, etc. will come, that some security domain where again some UTM, that is unified threat management, firewall, IDS, IPS will come, and system level also server systems, set of files also comes under system level. And at application level, the software applications, some access credentials, policy, and at data level, the data, databases, and storage. So, if you talk about an IT system deployed at web-based network environment, so compulsory, the system alone, generally the common perception is that IT system means that whether it could be a computer or a laptop or a notebook kind of thing, but it is not like, but it is a part of IT system. So that's why once we talk about IT system in a web-based network environment, compulsory it is partially or fully some extent linked with all these infrastructure deployed at network, security, system, application, and data domains. Again, why do IT system requires security? Again, it is to protect the devices, the software deployed at again the network, system, application, data domain from hackers or attackers. Ensures high availability of systems and services. Ensures business consistency and continuity, and secure ultimately data and data transmission. That's why compulsory IT systems requires security. How do we know there will be a security breach or threat? So violation of any one of the security parameters, such as the authentication, the confidentiality, integrity, authorization, access control, and non-repudiation. These we call the core security parameters. So violation of any of these 100% leads to there will be a security breach or threat. So one has to pay attention, even as a system administrator or a network administrator, see that is there any violation at authentication level, at confidentiality level, at integrity level, authorization level, access control or non-repudiation. See, just non-repudiation means that one should not neither deny nor accept for the thing what he or she has done. So, suppose, see, for example, a person who has sent a mail should not deny that I have not sent. Or a person who receives a mail and should not say that I have not received. So, non-repudiation means that neither sender nor receiver deny what he or she receives. So, similarly, authentication, confidentiality, integrity, authorization, access control. So, these are all the various security parameters. So, violation of any of either one or combination or many of these security parameters definitely leads there will be a security breach or threat. That's why again the role of secure programming comes into place to protect or to ensure all these security parameters. So, again, what will happen if there is a security breach or a threat? Again, hackers will take advantage of it to intrude into the organization network, to get access to the server systems, applications and database, steal or delete the sensitive data for sake of honor, business discontinuity or loss, business loss, deface if it is a website, deface website, web portal, inject viruses, trojans and many more to damage. So, that's why to avoid all these things, again the secure programming or defensive programming is essentially needed. So, again the threat landscape, we talk about how the threat landscape broadly categorized to it is a software based where viruses, worms, spyware, rootkits and so on, hardware based, again hardware trojans or fake components, and people, again inside or outside people. So, the total threat landscape revolves on these three verticals. Now, focus domains and some attacks. Again, the network system, application and data or database layers, these are all some designated or some commonly used attacks. Now, security challenges. Maintaining security posture by keeping the attack landscape in mind, maintaining security posture with changing business model and attack vectors is a challenging, and continuously protecting across a dynamic threat landscape. See, nowadays because of interoperability, the threat landscape is dynamically changing. But earlier mostly it is a device dependency was there, but nowadays device independent. A small example I will tell you, that some data captured from a camera, for example, immediately the same can be sent to either to some software application, through an email, through any other device. It means that dynamically the usage or the landscape is increasing. At the same time, the threat landscape also proportionately increasing. That's why continuously protecting across dynamic threat landscape really is a challenging issue. See, for example, nowadays the IoT, Internet of Things. So, once now it is also the upcoming area, again the threat landscape again exponentially going to be increased, and reducing complexity and fragmentation of security solutions. See, because so many devices, so many restrictions, so there is no single security solution to protect all the devices in a network environment. For that, again the security solution is again fragmented, and because of this fragmentation, again it is another big challenge. So, that's why reducing complexity and fragmentation of security solutions is also one of the security challenges. So further defensive programming is essentially needed. So defensive programming is a form of defensive design intended to ensure the continuing function of a piece of software under unforeseen circumstances. See that unforeseen circumstances. It means that whatever happened to the IT system, whatever attack going to happen, whatever attempts going to happen, but even such a situation, the IT system or the piece of software written for a particular application should function and for a continuity. Defensive programming practices are often used where high availability, safety or security is needed. Definitely, defensive programming especially is required or essentially needed to the applications where some real-time applications or where some sensitive applications, even some applications related to defense or so on. So definitely, the defensive programming role is very, very essentially needed. See, students, I want to say something is that earlier, even at 10-15 years back, writing, suppose, see, for example, 2 plus 3, a small piece of code to add two numbers. So that itself is a great challenge, that to write a small piece of code for addition of two numbers. But nowadays, because of so many the increasing threat landscape, so the programmers or developers has to write again a piece of code to protect that program for that functionality. So it means that, see, one positive way is that always the program ensures that 2 plus 3 equal to 5, and in parallelly again the developer has to write again a code to ensure that always there will be a plus between the 2 and 3. That we call it as a defensive programming, to defend. That's why nowadays, because of this increasing threat landscape, the percentage of defensiveness or defensive code is much more important than much more important along with the business logic of the code written for a particular purpose. So defensive programming practices are often used where high availability, safety and security is needed, and defensive programming is an approach to improve software and source code in terms of general quality. It means that reducing the number of software bugs and problems, making source code comprehensible. It means that the source code should be readable and understandable, so it is approved in a code audit, and making the software behave in a predictable manner despite unexpected input or user actions. What I would like to say is that once a piece of code written with defensive programming, always that software behave in a predictable manner despite any unexpected input or user actions. So these are all some of the characteristics of the defensive programming, which is nowadays essentially needed. Let's talk about some of the defensive programming techniques. See, there are many, but of course I listed out that some prominent techniques for being used in a defensive programming. Intelligent source code reuse, secure input and output handling, and also acceptance handling, canonicalization, low tolerance against potential bugs, architect and design for security policies, adopt secure coding standard, adhere to the principle of least privilege, sanitize data sent to other systems, practice defense in depth. So these are all some of the prominent defensive programming techniques. Of course, there could be many more, but these are all especially the programmers, the developers should always use some of these techniques as part of defensive programming to ensure that the software which has written for a particular application should always ensure its continuity, business continuity, despite any unusual incidents happens. Let talk about bit detail about all these defensive programming techniques. Suppose if you take intelligent source code reused, it means that if existing code is tested and known to work, reusing it may reduce the chance of bugs being introduced. It means that if you are successfully running source code without any bug, there is no harm that so one can reuse. And but if the source code, existing source code has some bug, we should not reuse. If you reuse that, automatically it will amplifies the damages of potential attack on initial code. So, and also if there are so many legacy problems, for example, this almost existing source code, if it has some legacy problem, the same problems also will continue. So in such case, but anyway, in positive front, intelligent source code can be reused if it is bug free, but we should not use if it has any bug. If we use this, again the source code, existing source code which has some bugs, again it causes so many problems. So one has to take, but of course in a positive front, intelligent source code can be reused, it can be if it is a erroneous free. Now the second technique, the secure input and output handling. See, input handling means that input handling is how an application or a server or other computing system handles the input supplied from users, clients or a computer network. Secure input handling is often required to prevent vulnerabilities related to code injection, directory traversal and so on. That's why input handling is once we enforce or once we implement input handling techniques, 100% the system functionality will not get disturbed. So that's why I am telling that, in especially in a web-based environment where inputs to be given by the end users or a customer, compulsory input handling features to be enforced. So that's why input handling is needed, those techniques, and then input validation also to be done. See, for example, no, whitelist, that is a whitelist means that acceptable things, and blacklist, these are all compulsory while input handling, these are things to be taken up. It means which are whitelist can be accepted, which are blacklist cannot be acceptable. So such kind of so handling features to be enforced. See, for example, suppose where there is some functionality where user has to interact with the database, in such case compulsory as part of input handling, the whitelist and blacklist should be clearly defined and enforced. See, for example, input should not be other than say a plain alphabets or maybe some numerals. Definitely, input should not have any special characters, because which will have so another adverse impact. That's why we call it as, you know, that flaws in input. So that's why especially when getting connected to database with some input where those inputs have some special characters, always leads. That's why, because whenever some IT system means they're connected to the database, always so many queries are being run at back end. So always certain queries will be compromised and get the data from the database will get also compromised. That's why, so as part of secure input handling, so whitelist and blacklist to be clearly defined, determined, decided, and those to be enforced. It means that which are characters to be accepted as part of input, that is a whitelist, and which are characters not to be accepted as part of input. Of course, the special characters, any other, can be accepted as a running text, but we should not be as a input where there is some validation being performed. And similarly, then terminate or stop or abort on input problem, filter input, encode or escape input. These are all some of the techniques being used to secure as part of input handling. Similarly, so secure again as part of input and output handling, let's talk about output handling. Output handling is how an application or a server or a system handles the output, for example, generating say HTML, printing, logging, and so on. It is important to keep in mind output often contains input supplied from users, clients, network, and database, etc. Secure output handling is primarily associated with preventing cross-site scripting vulnerabilities, but could also provide to be important in similar areas. For example, if generating Microsoft Office documents with some APIs, output management could potentially be required to prevent major injections. So encode output, these are all some techniques being used for output handling. So input and output handling, so securely handling input and output is compulsory, essentially to be implemented as part of defensive programming. Now the another technique is that canonicalization. Canonicalization means that it is a process for converting data that has more than one possible representation in a standard, normal, or canonical form. It means that, see, crackers are likely to invent new kind of representations of incorrect data. See, for example, if a program attempts to reject, suppose we have written some program where attempts to reject accessing the file. So generally in a Linux system or Unix environment, so password file will be in a slash root, then etc directory, followed by the password file will be there. It means that slash etc password. But the cracker or hacker or attacker may pass another variant of the file name, like etc slash dot slash password. It means that canonicalization ensures to avoid such type of bugs. What I would like to say is that it will identify and then it will avoid different, if inputs comes in different form to access the sensitive data. So that's why that example clearly says that. But see, for example, the standard to access the password file, generally the standard root path is that slash etc password. But crackers knows to come through different directions. Even though crackers are coming in different direction, it means that crackers or hackers use different route to come. The canonicalization will identify, diagnose, and prevent such attempts. That's why canonicalization is a process for converting data that has more than one possible representation into a standard, a normal, or the canonical form. And another technique is that architect and design for security policies. See, once you write this some code, compulsory at the time of architecting the program or designing level, compulsory the security policies need to be. It means that create a software architecture and design our software to implement and enforce security policies. It means that at the time of, because that at the time of designing the software, at the time of architecting the system that time itself, this care to be taken. That's why create a software architecture and design your software to implement and enforce security policies. Another technique is that adopt secure coding standards. It means that develop and or apply a secure coding standards for your target development language and platform. See, nowadays, see, especially the young software developers or programmers doesn't know about all these standards. So that's why it is a time, and one has to know that the secure coding standard, and then those things to be adopted. Otherwise, in a present, the increasing or the changing attack or threat landscape, it is very, very difficult for the software to run or to ensure its consistency and continuity. That's why compulsory one should adopt secure coding standards. It means that develop and apply a secure coding standards for target development language and platform. Students, see, one more technique is that adhere to the principle of least privileges. It means that every process should execute with the least set of privileges necessary to complete the job. Any elevated permission should be held for a minimum time. See, what I would like to say that always to have a security to ensure its continuity, always let follow the principle of least privilege, so that there will not be any damage, and whenever there is a need, that time it can be escalated and also for a limited or specific period. That's why this is a very useful technique. Simple example in a real-time application, I will tell you that. Suppose, see, you are a internet banking user, assume that. So there you have a freedom or total privileges to use your account in whichever way. But see, for example, say in terms of a limits, always put that transfer limit. Suppose if you put that money transfers are to some people, some accounts where you have to regularly do that. In such case, better put a minimum limit instead of putting a maximum. That's why whenever needed, then you can change the limits. So that is in terms of limits. Similarly, privileges also better don't the ultimate privilege is that as a root user, who has the overall control. But it's not at all always advisable each and every account is be root equivalent. So let give the use or give or enforce or use minimum privileges. Then whenever we need more privileges or higher level privileges, so can be changed or elevated that too for a specific period, so that the damage can be controlled. Another technique as part of defensive programming is sanitize data before sent to other systems. See, sanitize all data passed to complex subsystems such as command shells or relation database, etc. It means that before sending the data to any system or any network or anywhere, compulsory it is to be sanitized. Meaning of sanitized means that avoid unnecessary data. Send only which is used. Don't send the data of a garbage. So which is essentially needed, send only that. That is the meaning of sanitize data before sent to any other systems. Otherwise, those systems also get infected with all unnecessary things. And another important technique is practice defense in depth. It is also one of the techniques being used as part of defensive programming. See, manage risk with multiple defensive strategies, so that if one layer of defense turns out to be inadequate, another layer of defense can prevent a security flaw and limit the consequences of successful exploit. What I would like to say is that, see, for example, that's why I keep on telling that an IT system in a network environment, ultimately, say a hacker or attacker comes for what? To steal the sensitive data, correct? But the data is in a least layer, means that last layer. That's why first the hacker or attacker comes to steal data. First he has to come across the network, then come across, after that then to the system or a server, then after that the application, then after that the data. It means that it would be a fourth or a fifth level where the hacker attacker has to come down. So here the meaning of practice defense in depth means that each and every layer should be enforced with various access control or various mechanisms, so that even though one layer is compromised, at least the other layer will protect. See, for example, see, what I would like to say is that even though the firewall is compromised where the person entered from the network, but where he or she goes, he hits the system or a server. So if the system or server has enforced that ports control, in such case even the further the network will not enter into the, that network packet will not enter into the system. For example, even though the system is also compromised, again where it comes? It comes to the application. Then application level also can be enforced the security control. So like that, the meaning of practice defense in depth means that generally hacker or attacker generally comes, they ultimately for to steal or to damage the data which is at the last layer. So for that, on top of it, various layers are there, those layers all can be protected or properly securely enforced, so that if one layer got compromised, at least the other layers will protect. That is the meaning of it means that manage risk with multiple defensive strategies, so that if one layer of defense turns out to be inadequate, the another layer of defense can prevent security flaw and limit the consequences of a successful exploit. So this is also one of the techniques being used as part of defensive programming. And another, if you talk about exclusive application, so for that, always compliance with OWASP guidelines. See, OWASP means that it is a open web application security project guidelines to protect web application. There are so many mechanisms are there to prevent, to protect from violation, such as to protect from injection flaws, to cross-site scripting, not to properly configured system, or buffer overflows, insecure data flows. These guidelines of OWASP, if you follow or comply the OWASP guidelines, 100% at least most of the cases the application can be securely protected. Students, these are all various defensive programming techniques one has to practice and follow all these techniques or implement all these techniques while developing a code or writing a software code for any software application for any business. But essentially nowadays the secure programming is our defensive programming is essentially needed, and which will be embedded along with the business logic of the program, so that one way is a positively it means that the business logic is correct, but at same time if you embed the defensive code, so that the business logic will be protected and ensure the application consistency and continuity despite of any mischievous things, abnormal things happened during running of the that software or application. Then how do we protect IT systems? Again, by deploying secure devices and also enforcing access control and defensive programming, which we call it as secure code, at again network, system level, application level, database level, so that the entire IT system will be controlled. So, because now if you talk about the IT system in a 360 degrees, all these domains should be considered to protect, then only we can ensure the completeness of the IT system security. Say for example, if it is a network, again the firewall IDS IPS is required, and the system, the hardening of the OS is required, and an application by writing this secure code, like called source programming, defensive programming as part of software, and comply the application software with OWASP guidelines, and use digital signatures and OTPs also for non-repudiation and more authentication, and data database also before encrypting during data transfer, enforce encryption during data transfer from source to destination, and also it database end, and at least on sensitive data, and control access and usage of network systems and service. So these are all where we had to pay attention and enforce, so that one can protect IT systems. And as I told you, that even though all these things are there, these are all means that ensure its continuity and security, but always there will be a scope for violation too, as the hackers or attackers are continuously working to find a loophole in the entire IT system at all these domains. So students, I would like to just wrap up for a while what this topic meant for. So just I talked about that, what is a defensiveness and what is a defensive programming, what are its characteristics and defensive programming techniques, and how to protect the IT systems, IT system in a web-based network environment. So with this, I will conclude that defensive programming ensures the functioning of IT systems in a web-based network environment, and in turn ensures business consistency and continuity. The message of this topic would be, by keeping emerging threats in mind, defensive programming or defensive code should always be embedded with business logic for business continuity. I think students, you all, this topic would have facilitated to you, and with this I will conclude and I'll stop. Thank you very much for listening.